after qualifying, Hodders Walter Racing had the front row locked out, but 2 hours later, Luciano Savaral was awarded the Delano Pole Award and his number 5 Lennard. On the outside of the front row, Alessandro Rossini. The Hodders Walter cars were both pinged for blocking during qualifying, Adrian Devereaux on Jacob Card and Melanie Clavino on Greg Woodard. I'm not quite sure how Clavino could be pinged for blocking Woodard on the main straight, but be that as it may. Cars 2 and 7 are starting at the back of the grid, along with Arto Kakinen in the 9 car, who was sent to the back of the grid before this weekend even began because of that collision with Luciano Savaral during the round of France. Ingrid Hadeland, good qualifying effort there. You may have noticed the Schoberg cars are back, and they qualified very well, and the Midnight is in the top 10 as well. Archer Harris in the 79 car's first start of the year. Axel Andersson's home race. John Quackenbush of Toronto makes his first start for Gravity Racing. This is, I do believe, their first run as an Independence Trophy effort. Vijay Pushanda, we're being told this could be his last run in that car, either this week or Karjala. Cameron Taylor and Benoit Vuclair, I think, both need some good runs to safeguard their drives. And there you see all three of the fastest cars here all weekend. Kakinen, Clavino, and Devereaux all at the back. And Velocity Motorsports, well, Carlos Danzello and Dan McKay both publicly left the team. So I think Velocity Motorsports, I think we have already seen the last of them. Here we go, Luciano Savaral, and the lights are out, and away we go. Savaral gets a great start this time. Rossini goes to block Kevin Dwyer, but Dwyer is going to go around the inside, it looks like. So Rossini defending his position before he even gets to turn one. But Kevin Dwyer's got the inside. Savaral pulling away, though, in that car number 5. All of his major competition is all the way at the back of the grid. The Volpes did not quite have the same pace that Savaral had in practice. Savaral's pace in practice was frightening. But so is Adrian Devereaux's and Melanie Clavino's. After qualifying, Devereaux in particular was incensed. And Devereaux was saying that there was some very unsportsmanlike conduct going around, which coming from someone who has a grid penalty might seem a little rich, but be that as it may, here is Rossini in car number 3. He is definitely due to win his first Master Cup race. Some people have said that this could be his week. We'll have to wait and see. The Schoberg cars are back in a big way. We think that this team is using this race for R&D for Karjala. They only run these cars twice a year, here and at Karjala. They have new MA05s. Last year they ran year-old cars, or then-year-old cars, rather. Both qualify in the top 10, and while they're known at Karjala for being very aggressive, that team, I think we can expect them to stay out of everyone's way today. Scott Bates, car number 88, running 11th. He's not had the best start to the year. He's had a couple of crashes that he has laughed off in good humor. Bates, one of the more experienced guys out there. He has made good use of that experience. Look at that. He's going around. Packer Carroll around the outside. Is he going to make it stick? Yep, looks like it, because that next turn up ahead is a right-hander. Good thinking ahead by Scott Bates. And that's going to get him another position. So Scott Bates is definitely going forward. So we're looking at Frank Azure in the 46 car. The FAC Motorsports entry is running right there with Chris Dow. Oh, he gets into Davenport. Goes right into Davenport. Barges through. That didn't look nice. It looked like he just used the 84 car to make that last corner, to make that move.
Okay, I believe this is the first lap.
Oh, Davenport not happy about that. After Ingrid Hadeland had probably one of the worst debut weekends we've seen, here she is back in a big way. And when I say worst debut weekend, I mean the circumstances in which she had to make that debut with a car that basically had to be rebuilt, that she had no confidence in. This weekend, different story. Ingrid Hadeland in the 93 car is trailing her teammates, which is what we expected, but she's been pretty close to Nosova and Henton on pace. Yamino Tenchi in the Clockwork Midnight, looking pretty strong up here in 6th place. There's some big tire marks there. That's from Azuma Kazuyama. Had a bit of an off there in the morning warm-up in the Maximus car. So anyways, Tenchi looking to have a strong run out of the Midnight. This car is pretty interesting to look at under the hood. It's a lot different than most of the other cars here. Tom Moore running up in 21st place. I have a feeling we haven't seen the best out of Tom Moore yet. He's been pretty anonymous so far this season, but I think we'll have to wait till we get back to most of the short tracks later in the year, and then I think we might see some really good runs out of Tom Moore. He's definitely one of the better oval drivers we've seen come around in a while. And driver of car 19, watch out for him. Here's Danny Sauber, the rock star, back in 31st. Oh, into the side of Alenik, into the side of Joe Alenik. Chris Davenport almost got into that, as well as Kazuyama. Davenport has been front row seat for a couple of these already.
What's the fucking double standards here? If I did that, I'd get a fucking penalty, easy.
And, Davenport not happy. He's definitely going off on the radio, and as you already heard there, but Adrian Devereaux is already up to 25th place after we're on lap 3, so this 7 car, there's a very angry man behind the wheel of that car, and when we've seen Devereaux drive angry, we've seen some of the best, gotten the best out of him, seemingly, and that's what we're getting here, is he's going to rough up Tom Moore a little bit. Bump and run to the 19 car, and okay. Guess the stewards didn't like that. But anyways, now we're looking back here at Ingrid Hadeland in the 93 car, stuck behind Packer Carroll, who's doing a great job defending. Hadeland not very experienced, and Hadeland tried to cut that a bit short, but there was a curb there that's going to cost her some ground. That was Scott Stoidler, the 13, that went through. Jacob Carden, the 6, goes through. Here's the 34 of John Quackenbush. He's from Ontario. He's in Canada. Oh, off the track a bit. He's running in 30th. So Quackenbush is trying to hang on there. He's got Frank Azure behind him. This is Gravity Racing's first run here. And he gets a little bump from Frank Azure. Azure on a rampage so far. And Azure just turned him. That didn't look like that was even close. Azure just used them as the brakes. And I'm not surprised. Adrian Devereaux in car number 7 now working around Ian Cooper, who defends the inside. Devereaux going to try to swing it around the outside. Kuznetsov is up there. Cooper in the Ellison Becker car swings by to cut him off. Those are two guys that really don't mind putting the bumper to each other, but Cooper goes a bit wide. Devereaux is gonna try to sling through, and he does. Without too much of a problem. Oh, the 777 is making a run on the inside. Nope, there's a bit of a bump over there that he hit, and that upset him. Upset the car, and Devereaux is gonna go on through. Rossini and Kevin Dwyer. Look at Kevin Dwyer now poking to the outside. Now Rossini blocks the inside. Dwyer says, okay, I'll just go around the outside. Brilliant move by Kevin Dwyer. In the number 8, Myasoff Gessler. Roderick now, his teammate coming through. Rossini, I don't think he expected that one to stick, and I don't think he expected his teammate to follow right on through. Alessandro Rossini in car number 3, definitely fighting for it. But Kevin Dwyer and Leonard Roderick pulling away from him. Maybe he does have a problem here because they're pulling away a little too quickly here. I do wonder if something is wrong with car number 3, because Roderick, and yep, they're pulling away way too quickly. There's something wrong with the number 3 Volpe already. Rossini led the championship.
All right, Luch, you got a 10-second lead. The 7 car is coming through the field pretty fast. The 2 and the 9 are having some problems with traffic. Just keep it up.
Interesting that Savarell's race engineer, Gary Hall, there would alert him to the progress of Devereaux, Klevenow, and Kekkonen coming through the field. Anyways, with that being said, those are the only 3 cars that really have that I think can beat Savarell on pace, because the 7 is currently the quickest car on the racetrack, so I think we should keep an eye out for that. But that being said, as you see the running order there on the left, all 42 cars that started are still running. We have the battle for 10th here. Davina Henton in the 11, that is the 43 of Eric Bolander, who drove the infamous Manticore M1A1s at Coriolis a few years ago. The same Manticore M1A1s that Manticore Engineering then never updated until they finally retired the car at the end of last year. But Bolander really putting up a fight here against Davina Henton. Yulina Sova closing in. Henton gets it on the grass, or on the curbs in the sand, rather. And get pushed down there by Bolander. I don't think Henton's terribly impressed with that maneuver. Bolander holds onto the spot, though, so I thought the Schoberg cars were going to be pretty nice and just let everyone go by. I guess not. Here is Adrian Devereux, who's now gotten around Ingrid Hadeland in the 93. That didn't really look like that was much of a contest. The Hottas Walter Racing car, the Colton Morrell Altair, is a much quicker car in a straight line than the Lynx Racing car. Arto Kekkonen in car number 9. Gessler. A different paint job here. They're going to be running this for this race, Karjala, Russia, and I think that's it. That's more local sponsors on that car. It's a Finnish company on that car. Setting up the Katsev, that's Kuznetsov in the 15 car. Kuznetsov takes him deep. Kekkonen says, I'll break even later than you. And Kuznetsov going by on the inside. Kekkonen swings it wide. Nope. Kuznetsov's hanging on to 20th. Arto Kekkonen's not having an easy time out there with the young Russian. Kuznetsov is one of the more likable guys out there. He's got a very very passionate fan base, and after meeting Yevgeny Kuznetsov, it's really not hard to see why. Kekkonen's going to make a move here. Nope. Kuznetsov looks like he's going to be able to hang on. No, Arto Kekkonen he's going to get him, I think. Kekkonen didn't stick his nose out until a little bit late, and Kuznetsov was caught a little bit off guard. No, doesn't quite get it done. He's going to try to set him up again. Coming into turn 1, Kekkonen having fits with this 15 car. And now there he goes, finally through. But now he's going to deal with Packard Carroll. Gaspar D'Souza going by the 15 car as well. He's going to try. Packard Carroll in the 18 has been a bit of a brick wall out there. But granted, they're racing for position. He's got to be right to do that. Kekkonen goes by Carroll as well in the Nemoto. Packard Carroll having a good year so far. After two pretty bad years of Volpe, he's come into this Nemoto and we've seen a different driver seemingly. Melanie Klavenow throwing that car in. Melanie a bit flustered having to start at the back, I think. And it's showing a little bit more passive in traffic than Adrian Devereux and Arto Kekkonen perhaps. And you do wonder if that possibly could cost Melanie Klavenow in a race like the Karjala Grand Prix, which it's a pretty long race. And, you are going to see quite a bit of lap traffic. That has been a weakness of Melanie Klavenow's in the past, that she has had difficulty with lap cars before. Rossini in the 3 car, he's got a definite problem with that. He's bringing it in. Rossini is bringing the 3 car in. And we think that he may have lost fifth gear, and that looks like that could be an end to his race, especially with some of the longer straights here on this track. Here's the 44. That's Alvar Zetterberg, who's really sort of Schoberg's longest tenured driver. Zetterberg has been passed by Arto Kekkonen. Packard Carroll sliding it around as the 44 gives him room. And here's the 18 of Carroll now having to deal with Melanie Klavenow, who's going by on the wrong side of the track. But Packard Carroll is now trying to get by by Alvar Zetterberg. Klavenow boxed in. Not quite. Packard Carroll did a good job there trying to box Klavenow in. Look at that. He's going to go right through. Go right by Zetterberg as well. So Packard Carroll in the 18 car. Pretty good move there. But he also lost the spot to Melanie as well. Here's Davina Hinton in the 11 as she tries to hunt down Greg Woodard. Hinton off the course. Hinton's been very, very aggressive early on. She's going to get passed by both her teammates, Scott Stoiler, Arto Mendler. Hinton's going to lose a lot of positions. Little mistake over there. That's going to lose a lot of momentum coming down a long straightaway. That's really not where you want to do it. Melanie Klavenow's going by. So Davina Hinton, big mistake. She's got a lot of sand probably on those tires. And that's one car that I think Kekkonen may not have wanted to actually have to race with, because Davina Hinton is a very talented driver, the defending Karjala winner. Adrian Devereux in the 7. We're looking at a replay, I think, here. As there's the 43 car. That is the other Schoberg car with Eric Bolander as the driver. And Devereux now on Nasova. As he goes through, there's Davina Hinton. So this is what we're looking at a replay of. Devereux going around Hinton, it looks like. And there is the 41 of Greg Woodard up there in that yellow and blue car. And Woodard roughing it up a little bit with Eric Bolander. So, Greg Woodard in the 41 not having any of Eric Bullinder. Bullinder not having any of Greg Woodard. Adrian Devereaux, that was going to come right through the middle. Devereaux is going to, he's hard on the brakes, right in between Greg Woodard and Eric Bullinder, having their own little argument on the racetrack. And Devereaux says, thank you very much, gentlemen. I'll just go right on by. Let's have one more look at it. Now, that's a candidate for pass of the year right there. Woodard and Bullinder were beating on each other a little bit, using each other up. And Devereaux goes right in between the both of them. Does not particularly care if either one of them came down on him, because that's not what that move suggested. Adrian Devereaux, there's a reason he's a two-time champion. Here's Chris Johans in car number 12 having a quietly good race so far. The Alert Inglesbys aren't quite what they were last year, but Chris Johans in this 12 car, one of the more underrated drivers out there. If you want a man who can pull together a good result, fly under the radar for most of the season, and then all of a sudden you're in contention at the end, that Chris Johans might be your man. However, it's been a pretty slow start for the year for these guys. If he's going to get some points, Cariola has to be good for Alert. And we got a pit party here. Everyone bailing for the pit road. Johans in, as you see, just looks like just about everybody has come into the pit lane. His first round of pit stops. Looking at Kurt Pliskin in the Spark Boy car number 16. He is up to sixth place in this car. So Pliskin having a very good run there. And that would be one of Schoberg's cars right in front of him. So that looks like Bullinder may have gotten by the 16. And Pliskin could be on as well. Last time by the stripe, he was scored as being in sixth place. Pliskin in the 16 car. Adrian Devereaux, on the other hand, forcing his way through Zelda Ashby in the 55, who is currently leading the championship. So, 55 car, barely lost the round of France, not having such a good day here. A bit of a surprise, as Adrian Devereaux is rocketing up through the field. The 7 car is easily the quickest car on the circuit right now, and he's chasing down Scott Bates in car number 88, so Devereaux's going to have a bit of a harder time getting by some of these guys the further up the field he goes. Here's Carlos Requena. He's had a lot of giant-killing performances lately, and as a result, a lot of people in the garage have started to call him Rocky. So I think I've referred to him as Rocky on a couple of occasions. But Requena has been putting this cats up places that maybe doesn't necessarily belong. But then again, the Cats of Engineering is putting a lot of eggs into Cariola, and they have been doing quite a bit of testing with different configurations of their car on Raketa's car and in Kuznetsov's car. They've been trying a lot of different things out. Jimino Tenchi in the 25 car, going a lot slower than she was in the first stint of the race. You wonder now. Wonder if this 25 car is doing a bit of fuel saving, perhaps. As Adrian Devereaux goes by, Scott Bates going to challenge Tenchi. Oh! Bit of bumper tag. Tenchi hangs on to it. Car number 25. This car definitely is definitely one of the more eye-catching cars out there. Ian Cooper in the 777 car is actually the listed owner of the Clockwork Racing car number 25. It's not the he's slowing. He's got some problems. That's not the only arrangement like that. Packer Carroll is the listed owner of John Quackenbush's car. And that's Chris Davenport. Cooper had a problem. I think he was on his way into the pits. I think it looked like there was a puncture on that car, but now the 777's out of it.
You're sitting in the middle of a fucking racetrack. What the fuck was that about?
Davenport out of it, and he is furious. And it's not really that hard to see why. Anyways, as Tenchi is continuing to hold off Adrian Devereaux for fifth place. As you see there, Scott Bates in the 88 behind him is just waiting to see if any fireworks erupt. But Adrian Devereaux flying through this field. Packer Carroll's pit crew in the meanwhile. I think there's going to be some people fired because he's all the way down in 34th place. Terrible pit stop for Manicor Engineering. And terrible pit work on the Delgado de Garmo 19 pit box. I think there's going to be some people that are going to get a good ear lashing. Adrian Devereaux, in the meanwhile, is losing tons of time behind this 25 car. Tenchi onto the curbs, and Devereaux on through. Tenshi has to be doing a lot of fuel saving right now. I don't see any other reason why that car is going as slow as it is. Because if there was a puncture, then Tenshi would have been... Oh, problems for Roderick. He's just past pit in. He's not able to slow for pit in. It looks like he might have a puncture on the 4. Yep, I think that's definitely the case. I don't see any major smoke coming off that car. Quackenbush is a couple laps down, just went by. He's giving Devereaux room. Devereaux goes by. There's Tenshi, yep, Roderick in trouble. Anyways, here's Packer Carroll, who's back to 34th. The pit crew definitely blew it on this car. He was having a fantastic day. I think he could have challenged for a top 10. And it's usually common for some of the louder fans of the series to blame the crew chief, in particular Packer Carroll's, and particularly in Packer Carroll's case. And you know what? For once, I think they might be right, because whatever they were doing down there at Manicor Engineering, and whatever went wrong has gone horribly, horribly wrong. Packer Carroll is way out of contention for points right now, and really, it's not his fault this time. For once, I can't blame him. He's had one of the fastest cars he's had all year. Archer Harris running in 21st place, looking for experience for Curialum, giving Archer Harris a bit of screen time so that some people can recognize this tangerine orange colored car. Numbers that you can hardly read on the doors, but that's beside the point. 79 car could be a dark horse to qualify for Curialum. That's the Tenair, by the way. The 79 car was a Tenair last year as well. Tenair I don't think has ever qualified for Curialum, and some of the insiders are saying that the 79 car could be Tenair's best shot at making the race. Luciano Savarol, in the meantime, has got a sight up ahead that perhaps he's enjoying. Having to lap Leonid Roderick, and Roderick's giving him plenty of room. Roderick slows, gestured to let Savarol go by on the right side. Savarol goes through cleanly. That's the mark of a professional right there. Roderick's a four-time champion. Luciano Savarol has not won a race in almost 2 years. That's hard to believe, given the pace that he's had this season. Luciano's his day will come soon. Oh, Adrian Devereaux pitting early for the third round of pit stops. I think most of the field is saying you can only do this on three stops on four stops. Oh! Around goes Benoit Voeckler as he runs into trouble. That car was breaking down and then he got punted, so Voeckler's day is done. Looks like most people are saying that you're going to have to make a splash and dash late in the race, so it looks like a lot of teams are thinking to split their the final stint of the race in half. Yamino Tenshi in this 25 car, that car could be saving fuel. I don't think they can go the whole way, though. This isn't like Brands Hatch where there's plenty of areas to save fuel. I don't see how Tenshi's going to be able to do that, but Luciano Savarol is in. Again, looks like they're doing it. So this seems a little early, then that's because, as I mentioned, a lot of teams splitting their third stint in half. Kevin Dwyer staying out an extra lap. He's run up in second pretty much the whole race. Here is Ricketta leaving. Oh, wait a minute. There's a problem for Luciano Savarol. Savarol still in the pit box as Ricketta leaves. Disaster for Savarol. As now, Carlos Ricketta is ahead of Savarol on track, and there's Scott Stoidler in trouble in the 13 car. So disaster for Luciano Savarol in the number 5 car. Huge, long, long stop for Luciano.
Sorry, Luch, the fuel nozzle was disengaged. Just shut up and get back to driving. We're going to be in the top 5 anyway.
Savarol was running away with this one. He had about a 15-second lead, and that was a long stop, almost close to 45 seconds. So that's put him way out of it at this point for a win. But as Gary Hall said, as you saw him go by Adrian Devereaux, who was slowed up by Scott Stoidler, Savarol is still going to be in the top 5 as long as he finishes the race and doesn't crash. And he's got Adrian Devereaux right with him. And I'm not exactly sure if there's any love lost between these two. Is Devereaux giving Savarol a bit of the chrome horn, I think, possibly? Savarol pinching him down. I think Devereaux's not terribly happy about him about Saturday. Now, here's what happened to the 13, so... As you see, the engine's gone on the 13 car. And Melanie goes by on the on the left-hand side. I don't think he was expecting that. Stoidler in the middle of the track. I think he's coming in. No. There's too many cars going by him on either side. Jacob Card runs right in the back of him. I think Card slowed. Slipped if there's any fluid he was dropping, must have slid in that and right into the back of the 13 car. So anyways, that's going to put Kevin Dwyer in the lead of the race and Carlos Requeta in second. Requeta's never won a race. Kevin Dwyer went winless last year. He's never won on a road course before. Luciano Savaral did Devereaux get by? I think Devereaux got by him. So there's Devereaux in the 7 car. Yes, Devereaux is now hunting down Requeta in this 14 car. But then he's got to run down Kevin Dwyer in Carnivore 8. So Kevin Dwyer could be sitting in the catbird seat here. Devereaux versus Requeta. Devereaux throws it in. Requeta defends for all he's worth. Devereaux is going to be way on the curbs on the inside. I think he's going to be able to make it stick. And he does. Adrian Devereaux moves up to second place. Requeta back to third. Riquetta's now going to have to defend his podium against the very, very angry Luciano Savaral in car number 5. But Riquetta's trying to fight back. The young Colombian is definitely trying to fight back against Adrian Devereaux, but I don't think that car will let him. Carlos Riquetta, car number 14, definitely impressing today with a very solid drive. Kurt Pliskin, the defending winner of this race, he's not going to win today, but he's going to have a very good result. Well, he's not going to win unless there's some serious meltdowns at the front end of the field. This car doesn't quite have the pace to necessarily win, but he's got enough pace to show that he definitely knows his way around this racetrack better than his teammate does. Here's Jimino Tenshin, car number 25. I remember when Greg Woodard! Woodard, the 41! Greg Woodard was way off the road. There's got to be a problem with that 41 because that car did not slow down at all. Coming in over there. On back, Yamino Tenshi. As I mentioned earlier, Yamino Tenshi has not stopped yet. Has not made her final stop and is. This doesn't look like Tenshi's planning on doing a four-stop race. Gonna do it in 3. Woodard goes through! Look, that has to be a brake failure of some kind. Just look how far off the road he is, and look how slow Woodard is at rejoining. I think that definitely scared him. Woodard went to take his normal line and then realized he doesn't have any brakes, and he goes way, way off the course. Greg Woodard, one more look at it. Car 41. Yeah, that's definitely it. No brakes there. Look how he almost went almost into the Armco wall of it. That could have been a massive accident. Greg Woodard, he's rejoining it. I think he's making sure that he actually has brakes before he decides on rejoining. It looks like he's trying to bring it to a stop, but it looks like the 41 is going to refire and continue. So momentary brake failure, that definitely must have scared Greg Woodard there a bit, because I think that would scare just about anybody. As Arto Kekkonen, car number 9, continues to march his way through the field into the points. His 9 car not having the day I think he was hoping on having, especially when his teammate's leading a race. And that's a teammate that he has had an advantage over in speed all throughout the season so far. It's Brandon Larrell in the 39 car running a bit further back in the pack. Peter Short off the road up there in the 22 car, but Brandon Larrell, the 39, not exactly having the kind of year he wants. Makes a move on Cassie. Oh, no! Kuznetsov runs him over. Evgeny Kuznetsov just bowls over Brandon Larrell on the 39. That wasn't going to work. I think Kuznetsov tried to make a pass there, but that was no way that was going to work. And just punts. Poor Brandon Larrell, who I don't think saw that one coming. As Kevin Dwyer now, in car number 8, continues to lead as Adrian Devereaux begins to hunt him down. Kevin Dwyer could be looking at his second Master Cup Series win today. Here's Ingrid Hadeland in car number 93, who's had a pretty steady run. It's going to be a points finish if Ingrid keeps it on the road. That's all she needs to do. Keep it on the road. You got points today. Pat yourself on the back. Ingrid Hadeland will be running this car at Curiala. Don't know about any other starts for Ingrid for the rest of the year. Here is Melanie Clavino and Yamino Tenshi. Now, Melanie Clavino goes through. Tenshi lets Melanie through. Or does she? No, Yumino Tenshi going by on the inside. A lot of cars having problems passing there, but Melanie Clavino, whoa! Melanie Clavino and Yumino Tenshi are racing pretty hard over here. This is going to be fun to watch. Tenshi saving fuel. That's not quite how you do it. Going into this really tight hairpin. Is Tenshi going to let Melanie go? No, not exactly. Yumino Tenshi holds off Melanie Clavino for now, giving the Swiss driver fits. But Melanie is going to stick her nose in. She's going to be able to make it stick here. Or is this 25 car going to continue to be one of the biggest brick walls ever? This is up. Yep, Tenshi lets her go by. Yes, there must have been a call from the pit wall to pull over and let the two car go. Yumino Tenshi let, and look at that, Ashby is slowing a bit. Is Ashby going to pit? Yes, Ashby is coming into the pit lane. Like I mentioned earlier, some people were planning on splitting their third stint in half. Ricketta's doing so now. Not too many laps to go. Carlos Ricketta in the 14 into the pits right now. The 5 is in. Adrian Devereaux is in a lap later. And here we have Roderick, Melanie Clavino, and Yumino Tenshi. This is a bad place for Roderick to be. That's probably the worst case scenario for Melanie Clavino because, well, Tenshi just went right on by. Roderick held his line. I'm not quite sure what else you can expect from a lap car right in that part of the circuit. It's not a good place to catch back markers. It's really not because there's not too many places for them to go when there are cars behind them going side by side. Kevin Dwyer, car number 8. Doesn't he still has it? Oh, Peter Short merging from the pit lane. Kevin Dwyer gives him plenty of room. There's Danny Sauvin. Those two are racing for position, so Kevin Dwyer is in a bit of a rough scenario here. He doesn't want to get involved in that, and he doesn't. And while those two are going to squabble over whatever position they're running for, both of them way down the order. They've both had some pretty difficult days. Here's Danny Sauvin, the 91 car, twice a winner of the Crayola Grand Prix. Danny Sauvin off the road, rejoins. Peter Short's going to go through. He's had a bit of a rough day. Speaking of rough days, Gasper D'Souza in the 60 car. Doesn't seem like he quite has the speed in this car that he's had the past couple of races. Kevin Dwyer in the 8 car. Is he going to pit now? Looks like he is. That's Cameron Taylor in the 26 car. So Kevin Dwyer is pit, the leader is in. And after him, I think everyone will have made 4 stops, except for the 25 car. Yumino Tenshi is the only car that hasn't stopped yet. I think Clockwork Racing might be throwing down the gauntlet and going for it. And Clockwork Racing has not won a race, Kähkönen is in. So everyone but Yumino Tenshi has pitted. So, the 25 car pretty much is the only car on. Gasper D'Souza's in as well, so now everyone has stopped. Splash and dash for Arto Kähkönen. Splash and dash for Gasper D'Souza. But Yumino Tenshi looks like she's going to try it. You may have seen a glimpse of Kevin Dwyer in the background. This is one of the slowest cars on the track presently. Yumino Tenshi trying to hold on. Look at that lead is evaporating. Kevin Dwyer in the background is really beginning to close on this 25 car. Clockwork Racing has never won a race with this car. They haven't won a race, period, in their existence. They've been kind of on and off, never run a full season before, but they used to do some of Colton Morrill's R&D. Now they're working on their own car, the Midnight, by using a loophole in the engine regulations. There's a different engine configuration that Independence Trophy cars and part-timers can use, but it's a smaller engine and nobody in their right mind has tried it. But Clockwork Racing has, with this somewhat different configuration of a race car, they've figured out a loophole in that, and they've made something awfully quick out of it. There is Kevin Dwyer in the background. I think Tenshi might have just pulled on him a little bit because Tenshi is pretty quick in the middle sector of this track. In car number 25. She only has a couple of corners to go for Clockwork Racing's winless streak to be over. Kevin Dwyer nowhere in sight. Yumino Tenshi car 25 goes through the last couple of corners. She can coast it from here, and Clockwork Racing is going to steal it. Yamino Tenshi wins in Sweden in car number 25, one of the more popular wins in the garage to see this car take the checkered flag with that big smiling face on the hood of that car. Tenshi wins. Kevin Dwyer could not believe it that Tenshi had made fuel last that long. And Adrian Devereaux gets one back at Luciano Savaral by stealing the final podium spot. Rikketa completes the top five. Pliskin had a good run. Jacob Card, a bit of a messy day, but at the same time, we really didn't see much out of him. Other than that little ding with Scott Stoidler, he went off a couple of times late in the race, but he still managed to hang on to seventh. Arto Kekkonen was running him down late in the game. Didn't quite get there in time. Scott Bates and Melanie Klevenow complete the top 10. All three cars that were sent to the back of the grid came home in the top 10. So, there you go. Gasper D'Souza, who won from last at Brands Hatch, came home 11th. Nasova, Ashby, Ingrid Hadeland beats Davina Henton home. Setterberg and Bolander both came home with championship points. Chris Johans in there in 19th. And Matthias Taub, who won here a couple years ago, comes home in 20th with the Melrose team. That's a much-needed point for them and a boost to their ego because they got a lot of work to do if they're going to qualify for Karjala at this rate. Let's have a look at the championship standings as they enter the Karjala Grand Prix. No surprise, Ashby still on top of the boards with 215. Melanie Klevenow and Adrian Devereaux, though, are nipping at her heels. Rossini, Roderick, Pliskin, Andersson, Woodard, and Kekkonen all looking very strong with championship bids. Tenshi is 10th after her win here today, but Tenshi has only run four races this season and is not going to be running all of them. But remember, Karjala is a double points race. So, someone that doesn't have any points at all can come in, snag 140 points, and bam, all of a sudden they're in the championship pictures, assuming they're running the whole schedule, that is. Rikketa, D'Souza, and Kevin Dwyer wouldn't count out either, and Luciano Savaral has to be considered a favorite for the Karjala Grand Prix. I wouldn't rule out Scott Bates or Julian Asova to work some magic there. Matthias Taub has scraped together 41 points, but I have a feeling he's going to have a rough time going through Karjala qualifying. And Davina Henton, well, Davina Henton's the defending winner of the Karjala Grand Prix, and this year hasn't been quite as rosy as last year for the Lynx team. So I think Henton's going to need a little bit of help to avoid a major embarrassment. Now, let's keep in mind that the Independence Trophy pays points for the Karjala Grand Prix, but you could say that the Independence Trophy is at Karjala is a bit of a bonus event, because remember, best four results for an Independence Trophy car count towards the Karjala Grand Prix, not counting for motors options. So, some of these guys running for the Independence Trophy, it's in their best interest to qualify for Karjala. Then, if, say, they have a race where they conk out on lap one, they've got a bit of a safety to fall back on. So, with that being said, the next race, the Karjala Grand Prix, could very well impact the rest of the season, and there is a reason why it is considered the crown jewel of TM Master Cup Series racing.